Dhanshu Yashchandra, Ms. Volka, T.P. Rajivan, and H.S. Shivaprakash. This event will be moderated by Mini Krishnan. Shitanshu Yashchandra is among contemporary Gujarati literature's most eminent representatives. A poet, a playwright, translator, and academic, he has received several awards over the years, from the Sahitya Academy Award for his significant opus, Jatayu, to the Padma Shri. He has authored three books of the poetry. Volka is the pen name of Popuri Lalita Kumari. She has worked as a lecturer in Telugu at VSR and NVR College, and a senior executive for Usha Kiran Movies, Hyderabad. She was the executive president of Asmita Resource Center for Women from 1991 to 1997. Among her works are the novels Swecha, Sahaja, Manavi, Kanniti Keratala, Vennella, Gulabilu, and Rajakiya Kathalu, and Prayogam. T.P. Rajivan writes in Malayalam and English. In English, he has written Kanaki and a collection of poems. He has also edited an anthology of poems, Third World, Post-Socialist Poetry, with Croatian poet Lana Derek. In Malayalam, he has published various works. The various books are Adhe Akasham, Adhe Bhumi, The Same Sky, The Same Earth, and a travelogue, Purapettu Poya Vaakku, on the trial of the lost world. H.S. Shivaprakash is a poet, playwright, and a translator from Karnataka. His translations and adaptations of Shakespeare are widely staged. He has also translated European, Latin, American, and African poets into Kannada, and some of his best works, known Kannada and Tamil poets, into English. Winner of the Sangeet Natak Academy Award for Playwriting and the four best book prizes of the Karnataka Sahitya Academy for Poetry and Translations, he is a former editor of the translations journal Indian Literature. He is currently a professor, theatre and performance studies at JNU, New Delhi. Mini Krishnan is editor translations, Oxford University Press. So far, she has edited 84 full-length translations, five of which have won national prizes for her translation. She is member with the Indian Literature Board, a Ministry of Culture initiative to promote Indian writers in the 6 UNESCO languages. And she served as PAC member, National Translation Mission, and was the founding editor of the South Asian Women Writers website, hosted by the British Council, and the literary advisor to the Hindu. Over to you, panelists.
Thank you very much. Though narrated, right, before the session, what's really important is a book launch, a book released for the public.
I would like to take this great opportunity to announce the launch of H.S. Shivaprakash's book, Everyday Yogi. It is an English translation by his Kannada book, which was a bestseller published in 2003. The original book was titled Bhattis Raga. It is an account of his experience with a yogi, a Sufi, and a Christian evangelist. Sir, please do the honors.
Each of these books for us?
Yes.
Then can you distribute for us?
Yes.
You should give to each of us.
What's the title of the book? Everyday Yogi. In some sense, Indian writers are everyday yogis. I welcome you to a session that talks partly about, well, the two are anyway linked. The two are linked. Writing in Indian languages by, here we have just a very small representation. And as Shiva Prakash has said in one of his influential articles, which I read a long time ago, I hope I won't misquote you, he says there's no such thing as a representative writer from Kannada because there's so many different kinds of communities, so many complex issues. So that is the same from Telugu, the sweet language. They say Telugu is the Italian of the East. From my own language, Malayalam. And Rajivan, who's, I think one of the things she didn't say is that you used to publish poetry, publish other people's poetry, the Yeti books. And of course, dear professor, who is an academic, very decorated writer. Ours is a great safari, actually. It's a great mela. I thought I'd say that the popular interest in literary prizes, literary events like this has gone hand in hand with the globalization of English. And it has also thrown up situations where the past and the present seem to mix. Like Anantamurthy said, India is a country where different centuries coexist. Colonialism, post-colonialism, so all of this is extremely complex mix. Dealing with a sort of a medieval background, but struggling to come out and knowing to Western knowledge systems. All of this is not just an Indian writing in English, but it is impacting our writers in our Indian languages strongly. Now, to make words travel, to put a world into a mouth, you know, the language itself. Remember, ours is a highly oral culture till very recently, when the print systems came. This has been made possible by people who worked closely and followed closely the work of the regional language writers. The theme of this, which is the personal, is also the universalization of experience, and to some extent, I have to keep mentioning translation. Translation is really a substitute for the text, substitute for the experience. But in the absence of a tongue and an eye that cannot reach the original, it is the primary text. With these words, and also we have to remember that the e-book thing has demolished distances even more efficiently, though it hasn't caught on as much here. These are some of the points I would like to raise, as also this that... there's a great deal of conflict, a great deal of discussions about translations, who a good translator is, what they should carry through. I'd just like to say, that I'm talking about translations into English, you see, the early translations into English were not done for Indians. They were done for Europeans. So that hangover, those of you here who are below 40 would cannot even imagine what a struggle it was to come out of that mode, which was achieved in the late 70s, 80s. David Devadar with Penguin started that, and more efficiently, more recently, 90s and so on. They are working hand in hand with writers in the regional languages. Ladies first, so I will first ask Volga to comment on what she thinks of how she finds her words transported into other worlds, you know, literary crossings, forging connections. These are themes I want to offer her, and how she sees, when she first wrote, how she located herself in her own milieu, in her context, and then when it had to, and in how it was perceived by a translator, and perhaps the publisher and the reading public, because, you know, when you write an Indian language, you don't sort of project or predict how it might function in translation. But then comes the connection, then the text is no longer yours, the world is free to comment, and then comes this situation of how relevant is it to the next reader. You must also remember we are functioning at a great disadvantage because of the language inequalities, the cultural, because the global economic things are have been against us. At this, I mean, the writings of our writers make available are accommodated by a European norm. You know, even now, the great world prizes, most of the jury is made up of monolingual readers. So they may not even be able to perceive or to understand the complexities of art. So over to Volga, and then we'll take it by turn, Professor. Volga.
Thank you, Amini. I'm happy to be here with all of you. I came here with a very short notice, but the love and affection of Kannada women writers towards me brought me here. Because my works were translated into Kannada extensively, women writers from Kannada start loving me. This year, I released a short story anthology of a very well-known writer, Banu Mustaka, in Kannada, in Bangalore. And a couple of months back, I presented the very renowned award, Anupama Niranjan Award, to Lalita Nayak, a very well-known tribal writer and activist. So I'm very proud to be in those occasions with Kannada women writers, and they know me through my writings, and I know them through their writings. It's possible because of translation. And when I saw this subject, I'm a bit confused. Personal, universal, nationhood, and translations. Usually for me as a feminist writer, the order is personal, political, nationhood, and womenhood. And I remember my poem when personal is political, you all know that feminist this thing. And I once wrote women we always call Mother Earth. If a woman is Mother Earth, and Earth divided in as nations, and nations breed races, is the burden of protection of nationhood and purity of race is the responsibility fell upon women. So the connection between personal, universal, nationhood, these reminded me of many things. But the topic is strictly located to translations. I have many things to say, not about my writings and the translations of my writings, but my experience with translated works into Telugu. I became an universal person because of many books translated into Telugu from various other nations. My generation people and people of younger than me or somewhat older than me grew up with Soviet literature. 2 weeks back in Hyderabad, we have 100 people gathered and talked about the Soviet books we read, the beautiful books, children books, progressive publishers. They published in 60s, 70s, 80s, beautiful books with many colors, good binding, good printing. And in Telugu, we read Gorky, Tolstoy, Pushkin, whatnot. And inspired by those translations, many other writers translated Mark Twain, Charles Dickens, Pearls Burke, Somerset Maugham, many, many international writers came into Telugu language and our horizons were broadened. So without those translations, the rootedness in the literature was not like this today. So translations, I think, from one language to another language, and those days, 60s and 70s are the days of this universal you are calling now, they are internationalism. Nationalism, internationalism. So that internationalism, antarjatiyata, we called it. We are citizens of the world, not only one nation. That feeling was in 60s and 70s through the masters of the world literature. So those memories, 2 weeks ago we shared at Hyderabad, some friends who are inspired and by these writers translated. Then, and one thing, what I feel, I read Mark Twain in English, Gorky in English, Charles Dickens in English, and also in Telugu. But when I read the Telugu text, I feel more attached to that text, Telugu text, than English text. Because that language is so important for me. My language is so important for me. Though the English word is the original word conceived by the author, but it came into my language so sweetly, so smoothly, I never feel that this is not good. Those were the very good translators did that work, like Uppala Lakshman Rao, Nandur Ram Mohan Rao, when I was 12 years old or 15 years old. When I read the Mark Twain, Tom Sawyer in English, I won't relate with Tom Sawyer in English at all. But in Telugu, Tom Sawyer is my boy. So the power of translation is also there. Some feel that something will be missing. Maybe something will be missing. But something will also be added. The flavor of the language, the idioms, and the colloquialness, all these things were added, the colors were added by the translator, gave such a flavor to the original text. So I love translated works as well as originals. I myself translated many English novels into Telugu. I translated Agnes Medley's Daughter of Earth into Telugu, and it raised lot of debate in Andhra Pradesh. It was discussed as if it is a Telugu novel. And I translated Alexandra Kollontai's Three Generations. And for years, 2 years, Kollontai was discussed as if she was born in Andhra Pradesh and as if she wrote in Telugu language. And her name was so familiar with Telugu people with that small book called Three Generations. So translation has that power of making issues. So these are my experiences with translations. I'm also, my stories were also translated into various other Indian languages as well as English. And as I told you in the beginning, because of those translations, Kannada women and women writers make me one among themselves. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Are we headed for a literary McDonald's? Is the next question. And if you, I'd really like you to talk about your writing and keeping to the issues, if you want to add to some of these issues that Volga has raised.
Minichi, as we know, when our work is translated into another language, if you don't know that language, what happens to us? My poems have been translated into German and, you know, all sorts of languages. So we go there, poetry festival, we read something from Gujarati which they don't understand. Then they read German, which I don't understand. what is happening here? What is happening here is a kind of notion of my being a poet, a notion which I really dislike. If there is someone who sits next to me and constantly sort of, you know, is a poet, then I would rather read his poem than sit next to him. So this effort on part of many, many of my contemporaries to be after the translators and to say that my poems have been translated into so many languages, I think there is something wrong with it. And our session should figure out what is wrong with it. On the other hand, as a reader, I love my mother tongue. Absolutely, I write only in Gujarati. No problem, because you talked of one person jury, person who knows only, you know, juries which know only one language. The jury for me is myself. You know? If I like a poem, I write it. And if I don't find it good, I don't publish it. With that kind of relationship with poetry, my relationship with my mother tongue is also influenced by this understanding. So what is my mother tongue? My mother tongue is not a prison house. My mother tongue is my mother's lap. And two mothers are seated here. Would you ever like your child always to sit in your lap? No. After 3-4 years, if the child goes on sitting in your lap, you say, please go now. And genuine mother tongues also do that to you. That is where translation starts. So those who understand poetry, those who enjoy reading poetry, if they can read other languages, they should bring back that to the mother tongue. Now, what kind of things do we bring back to the mother? There are some of our travelers who go to Paris and, you know, New York and all sorts of places, Moscow and so on. And the touring company would say that to Gujaratis, that in Paris we'll give you jalebi and in London we'll give you puri bhaji. Something similar happens in translation. Sometimes we so very much indigenize the translation. I beg to differ with you that the characters from other languages should not become absolutely Gujarati characters. I would like Tom Sawyer to be an American boy about whom I could read in Gujarati. So to me, translation is a travel and a travelogue. It's a travel because I like to travel. But it is a travelogue in the sense that I write about it in such a way that my reader is able to go to some foreign places. And the foreign places could be in India and they could be outside India. In fact, first we should explore this vast country of ours, so rich in literature, before we really think of Gorky and Mark Twain and Baudelaire and Mallarmé. They're nice, but so is Shiva Prakash. I mean, I would rather like to have him in my language rather than that. So these are the various ideas that, these are various concerns really and various anxieties that I have about translation.
Sadly, the intra-language publishing is not that brisk. The editing is also not so dedicated. Things are just rushed out, sometimes like a printer's job. But I really would like Professor Shiva Prakash to share some of his experiences, concerns. He's spent long years in Germany now, and it's performing arts as well as other things and academic concerns. Professor?
So thank you, Volga and Sitam Suji, for set the discussion going. And some issues have already been raised. And I'm very glad that Sitam Suji drew attention to intra-linguistic translations in India. A lot has been said about translation into English and from English, and so much that it reminds me of a parable of Mullah Nasruddin. Once Mullah Nasruddin lost his key, and you're looking for it on the royal road in the open daylight. People asked him, he was desperately looking for my keys, I can't get into my house, my keys are lost. And they said, Mullah, are you sure you lost them here? He said, no, I lost them in the dark rooms. Then why are you looking for it here? Because there's more light here. And this is how a lot of our translation theories work these days. Though I'm an academician, and because I'm also a writer, I can be a little mischievous about these academic misdirections. Now, it's true that we got a lot from the West. We got Shakespeare, Gorky, and so many others. But isn't it ironical that a major Indian poet like Sitam Seshachandra has not yet been translated into Kannada? Forget about contemporary literature. Silapadi Garam, which is, to my mind, as important as the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, how many Indian languages has it been translated into? And our bhakti texts of our gems of our bhakti literature are being translated into different Indian languages through English translation. Some Ramanujan comes up from Chicago, he translates the Vachanas, and that becomes the model. And what happens? The terrible mistakes in Ramanujan's translation. Just because something is good English, it passes these days. But it may be good English, it's not good translation. Because if the major significance or significations of source texts are lost, what good is the translation? For example, just to register my dissent about Ramanujan's translation, the Vachana texts are intensely dialogic in Kannada. Ramanujan makes them monologic. He removes the addresses because his model of poetry was the British poetry of the 60s, the second phase, the last breath of English modernism, where poets were tired of talking to the world and they started talking to themselves. It was a whisper. Poetry became a whisper. One felt ashamed about. It's that kind of language that Ramanujan translates, that dialogic, intensely dialogic and dialectical Vachanas into. So let me not talk about that, but it's important to translate between all languages and then translate them into English. One of the biggest translations problems with the translation scene today is this, and I've discussed this with Mrs. Minikrishnan long ago and many of my publisher friends, and I was also editor of Indian literature. If we want a Bhili text from Gujarat, we need to get a good translation of Bhili Ramayana, Bhili love poem or a heroic poem. How do we do it? The problem is, the person who knows the Bhili language and the Bhili text well doesn't know English. And people who know good English don't know the source languages. This has happened to many of our great writers in Kannada have suffered because of this. And my own Guruji, Chandrasekhar Kambhaji, is sitting here. He is one of the greatest poets in my language, but is so poorly translated into English. And people don't see. Some other second-rate poet who gets a good translator becomes an international poet. So there's a politics of translation which one should remember. So what do we do? How do we, this is a very practical problem. How do we get good translations? We can't wait for somebody to turn up, a Bhili person, to go to Oxford and Cambridge and learn their language, or some Kannada scholar who knows Kambarji's poetry very well to learn Chicago English, or even between our languages. There are lots of differences, and Indian languages are supposed to be related. The association nuances of the same words completely change when we go from one language to language. For example, something like palahara in Kannada means it's a fruit dish. In Tamil, it means breakfast. The same word. For example, the word bhayankar in Kannada is frightening. In some other language, in Malayalam, excellent. And in Marathi, bhayankar. Bhayankar best. Bhayankar best hai. Chai, bhayankar best hai. Excellent chai. So the nuances, we have the same words, the nuances change. So even between our languages, somebody who knows, and also the quantum of Sanskrit words that are acceptable in each language. For example, Telugu and Malayalam, they are comfortable with a lot of Sanskrit diction in their language writing. Whereas a language like Kannada or Tamil, we're impatient with Sanskrit. We hate too much Sanskrit. When one of our poets, Kuvempu, was a great poet, otherwise a great poet, wrote Ramayana Darshanam, full of Sanskrit words. Another poet, K.S. Narasimha Swami, said, Kannada putadali yeni samskrutada padagala meravanige. What is this procession of Sanskrit words on the Kannada page? Kannada madhyamavagaleveku Kannada makkalige. Kannada should become the medium of instruction for Kannada children. Kannada madhyamavagaleveku modali kavigalige Kannada kavigalige. It should first become the medium of instruction for our Kannada poets. No more Sanskrit, he says. So this debate is a very interesting debate. How much of Sanskrit to accept and how much to keep out? In Kannada, this debate has been going on since the days of Kaviraja Marga. So given these differences, we cannot wait for an ideal translator who is good in both the languages. So though we speak of the death of the author in the present day theory, we still believe in the survival of the individual translator. So today, let's declare the individual translator dead. So we should go in for more of collaborative translations. So these experiments some people have made, I myself made. For example, when Vachanas were translated into three South Indian languages, I was in charge of this translation workshop. We decided, see, this good language scholars cannot be good translators. If good language scholars or people who know a lot about the language can be the best translators, all lexicographers would have been the greatest translators of the language. We need a poet, a writer to translate the language. So we paired off a Kannada writer with a Malayalam writer, Telugu writer, and a Tamil writer, and we had a resource person. So it was a collaboration which consisted of four people, and these translations worked very well. So we should, to tackle this big problem that is nagging the scene of translation, I think it's important that we declare the individual translator dead and move into the era of collaborative translations.
I'm a little dismayed to hear this applause. I agree, of course, collaboration is important. The editor also plays a role, sometimes helpful, sometimes not so helpful. Talking of different meanings, the way meanings change, Dr. Rajivan will tell you that Good Friday in Kerala is known as Dukkha Valiyacha. But in Karnataka, it is called, what is it in Kannada? No. Good Friday in Kannada is called what? Any Christians here? Shubha Rakshima. That's right. So, like that, there are different meanings in different languages. I'd like to request Rajivan now to share his experiences. He's handled a great deal of material, and modern Malayalam, very contemporary Malayalam. We Malayalis are also slowly developing sort of anathema to Sanskritized vocabulary, reaching grassroots language, which is in many ways very difficult to translate. When I was working with 17 or 18 translators to publish the Oxford Anthology of Malayalam Dalit Writing, the editor, Dasan, wanted that how some of it is so oral that we can never bring it into print. So I said, let's not have a text like that, but you put it into the introduction. Let's show the failure of print. We'll have a transliteration of the original Malayalam. Then we'll do it in English and say it has failed, actually. Nothing is coming through. So there's no harm in admitting failures. But I'd like Rajivan to talk about his experiences.
My question is, that I often ask myself is that why we need translation, for whom it is. And what I always find is that translation is not an innocent, impartial activity. It's a kind of, it is certainly a political activity. Political activity in the sense that we don't translate all kind of texts. We translate or would like to get translated text that fits into our own ideological positions, our own needs. During communist movement, like Madam said, Soviet literature brought many communist writers, mainly political writers from Soviet Union. After that, during the capitalist period, there are many European American writers who were translated. During the Bhakti movement in India, our classic Ramayana, Mahabharata, translated into many Indian languages. All this show that translation is not an innocent, impartial, simple activity. There are a lot of political, ideological, religious activities behind that, forming the language of translation, how to translate it. If Masindoki's mother, if we translate it today, it won't be the text that was brought here by the Soviet Union Pravad book house in some 10 or 20 or 30 years back. And another question is that why this has become political is in selection of a book for translation, in selecting the author, in selecting the publisher, in all these activities, there is politics, there is business, there is market in it. Every language, I think, is a nation. Every language, a nation, a society, a people that is evolved through centuries of natural, environmental, political, historical transformations. A word is a bird has its own history. So the challenge of a translator is to find the emotional complexity of behind each word, its transformation. This is what Mini Krishnan said, that it's Good Friday, how it's become Dukkavelli Aicha in Malayalam. Another aspect of political translations, even in Ovidian's Kasakindi Dikasam, which is very, very popular, perhaps one of the milestone in Malayalam modern fiction, when there is a character, Achap Allapicha Mallaka. It's a local word, that the name of a very poor priest, Muslim priest. When he translated himself, his work into English, that word is character is, it is, he's not there. He became a Muslim priest. Muslim priest is a generalization. So how far generalization we can make? Culture-specific details we often sacrifice for when we translate. And another thing is that one other challenge, when we translate fiction, the main challenge is translation of dialogue. Narration is okay. Narration, that is, it communicates a kind of information. It's a kind of technical writing. But dialogues between characters, dialogues carry the emotional weight, the emotional context. Everything is in dialogue. It won't be complete grammatically. It will be some words or, you know, just some sounds. How that can be translated into another language? Another language is another domain, another country, another nation. So it is this again make translation a very complex political activity. Into when we think of how is it possible? Another question is that Shiv Prakash said that okay, I mentioned translation of Vajana poems are not good like that. I don't think there is good or bad translation. There is only translation only. Good English, but it is not the poem is not that much conveyed into his English. So what I say is there is no good translation, bad translation. We have to take it at translations. How far it communicates? Yes, there is no good poem or bad poem, good novel or bad novel. It is an independent work. It is not an extension of Vajana poets. Or Samskara, when Ramanujan translated Samskara, I don't think that it is an extension of Anantamurthy's work. It is Anantamurthy's work, like the life of Brahmins in Kannada, was the material, raw material for Anantamurthy to write that fiction. Anantamurthy's fiction was the raw material for him. Translation is entirely, totally different activity, which is very creative, which demands the same creativity as of the original writer. So it has to be respected like that. So this is my, you know, disconnected.
I'm delighted to hear that translation is as creative, and in fact, only creative people can translate and should translate. So certain notions that, you know, anyone can translate, anyone who knows two languages. No, bilingualism is different from being bicultural. Or you have to have with you, working closely, and in great trust, both the author and a collaborator who could be some sort of a bridge. I think it's time to throw the floor open for questions. If anybody has anything, please, yes. Could someone please hand a mic over?
Can I ask, sir? Firstly, I would like to thank all the panel members for this, I think, a very needy and important discussion on translations. We talked about internationalization of translation, but before that, being honest, because of the very political scenario, cultural disknowledge, and lot of aspects related to the translation in terms of emotions also that you told, sir. I think that inter-translations, intra-Indian language translation is more important, because Kannada, Malayalam, Telugu, Tamil, or of any languages, they are very much interrelated in terms of understanding. Even though we don't understand very much Gujarati, but at least we can, after, if you say some Gujarati word, we can track some 60 to 70% very easily. Similarly happens with Kannada or Telugu or like all the Indian languages. Very much interrelated to each other. Don't you think the translations of the literature, whether it is poetry or any other thing, should happen inter-Indian languages, means intra-Indian, like various Indian languages, including Sanskrit, before going internationally, so that the emotions become richer, the meanings become richer, and you know, when the meanings become richer, the security also is there on the literature as a part. Because then if internationally somebody makes it politically or culturally, whatever his motto is, incorrect, then you can tell him that, see, this is translated in 10 languages in India, and this is the richer meaning of the text. You are playing with the text. So don't you think this should happen?
It should, as you said. And very happy that the younger India is saying this. Now, let's pay attention to the names of our various states. These are not Gujarat or Bengal and so on. These are, as you know, language-based states. The funny thing is that vis-a-vis the formation of the states, the Indian state and the Indian society are at loggerheads. The Indian states, Indian state, want the political power, as you rightly said, sir, that the politics of translation. Now, Indian state wants each state to be unilingual. This is how they like. Now, Indian society, there is no single Indian state which is not multilingual. If I want something to be translated into Gujarati from any part of India, there are enough number of people living in Gujarat today who know from, you know, Kashmiri to Malayalam, from Mizo, my students are from Mizoram, to sort of, you know, Kutch, which really is a separate language. So let us make use of the counter move that Indian society has already made to the unilingual states that have been formulated by the political power. And how do we go about doing this? Exactly by what Shiv Prakash has said. He said, very memorably, he said that the single translator is dead and the multiple translator has arisen from the ashes of this. So and I think several of our institutions are already organizing such workshops, and it would be wonderful if any Gujarati speaking Kannadiga and any Kannada speaking Gujarati meets me, I'll be very happy to form a small group of direct translation between these two languages in any other language.
Just one more thing I want to add. I'm very happy that this whole question of the politics of translation has been risen. But I'd like to say one thing to add to what Rajivan said. We translate so-and-so because that author is imposed on us because of a certain kind of prevailing politics. This is not always true. For example, many post-colonial translation theorists now tell us that we translated a lot of Shakespeare because Shakespeare was imposed on us by British education. But British education also imposed on us Milton's and Tennyson's and Wordsworth. Nobody cares for them. But Shakespeare survived. Because something that goes beyond politics. Because translation itself can create a kind of counter-politics. I'll give one example of this. In Karnataka, when during the period of the inception of modern Kannada poetry, when B.M. Srikantaya was translating Palgrave's Golden Treasury into Kannada, all these leading poets, because B.M. Srikantaya was associated with the Mysore Palace and he was the supporter of Raja Seva Sakta, British government. In North Karnataka, Bendre and other poets, poets who were writing more in the dialect, were translating poets from Ireland and Scotland and so many small countries of Europe. Because for them, for example, Bendre translated the national songs of all the countries except Britain, of Ireland, Scotland, Sweden, and so on. Because B.M. Srikantaya translated this Rule Britannica rule, he translated this. So translation is a creative activity. It's also a political activity. It creates a new kind of politics. And it's important to tie it up with what Sriram Shuji said, to this monolingual imposition that is happening, at least bilingual English and Hindi. We have to create a counter politics by, re-emphasizing and reasserting our multilingual identities.
In this era of globalization, translation militates against this unification, this sort of one world, one language, one. I believe we have time for just one more question.
There were two recent incidents that happened that sort of underline the importance of accurate translation. One was the case of Hinduism and Alternative History by Dr. Wendy Doniger, And another one that I have recently been reading about myself was Sri S. L. Bhairappa's books that have been translated into English, Avaran and Mandra and Sartha. What I have, it's just a personal observation of mine that when these books have been translated into English, what has happened is that a lot of political thinking that goes on in the English language has been sort of, I feel that it has been superimposed onto the original concepts in Kannada that would have been there. And when I read them in English or my mother reads them in Hindi, they say that the sentences do not read correctly. The emotions do not read correctly. And when people have been debating about Hinduism and alternative history, they say that the entire politics of sort of post-colonial and colonial politics has been imposed onto that translation of Hinduism scriptures. Whereas right now, we do not have sufficient expertise, we do not have sufficient experts who are out speaking there in the public about what has been our own culture, our own texts. So can you shed some light on that?
Anyone wants to say, or shall I? First of all, Donija's book says this is a version, her version. Secondly, any of those, it is actually a colonial thing that picked up Bhagavad Gita and made it so important, so central, there's so many translations. So I don't have a very sort of definitive or final answer to this, except that it's precisely this which is creating the problems, that there are so many versions, and our own ignorance of our own languages, we come right back to that. We're talking about intra-language publications, translations and publications. How do you think we reach the public? They won't even buy the books. If you look at any railway station and you look at the serious bookshops, there is a big difference. No, people are in such a hurry, they don't have time to even go to a bookshop to buy books. So, you know, there's a question of marketing and so on. Publishers also have to live and eat. So there is a problem there, whereas the English publishing industry is slightly more organized, still massively disorganized compared to other countries. And if you look at the huge distances that have to be covered in our country. Now, some Flipkart, Amazon, that sort of thing has come up. Otherwise, it was very difficult. So this is it. Our own, see, we were taught for many generations to look down on ourselves. And I think your generation is the last chance we've got. You have to recover. You have to learn your own languages. You have to retrieve. You have to save and protect it, because it's your memories, you know, your histories. And your own, your identity. You know, there's that saying in the Siri language, where is your placenta buried? You have to know where you are, what your roots are, because language, culture, you know, land, language, culture, they're all connected. So sure, learn the world language, learn the prestige language and all that, but keep a good grip on your own languages. And try to learn at least one other language. Ours is a polyphonous system, and all Indians are actually polyglots. You know, if we make that effort, we can learn it. But unfortunately, our education system is against. You know, people are punished if they speak, don't speak in English and so on. No time. So, does anyone want to add anything? Rajiv, want to say anything? Olga? So, thanks very much for listening patiently during lunch hour. Jai Hind.
Thank you. That was a wonderful session. I request the panelists to sign on the BLF wall. Those who wish to get a book signed, please, you may head to the signing area. A couple of announcements. There's a BLF meetup happening. Everyone is invited to participate. It's a bring your own book barter where you can meet, interact with people, and exchange books. It's happening from 3 to 4 at the amphitheater. This year, the BLF is not just about the written word. We have at the festival a wonderful showcase of contemporary art and sculpture. Bangalore Literature Festival, in association with our venue and hospitality partner, Crown Plaza, Bengaluru, Electronic City, proudly presents Forms, Faces, Forces, an exhibition celebrating motives and emotions that books bring alive. Curated and conceptualized by Gallery G, the exhibition is on at the Crown Plaza lobby and as well as the festival area. Thank you.